Welcome to Season 2 of Public Health On Call, a podcast from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. I'm Joshua Sharfstein, Vice Dean for Public Health Practice and Community Engagement, and a former secretary of Maryland's Health Department. Our goal is to bring scientific evidence and experience to the public health news of the day through informative interviews with scientists, community leaders, policy experts, public health officials, clinicians, and more. If you have ideas or questions for us to cover, please email us at publichealthquestion@jhu.edu. That's publichealthquestion@jhu.edu for future podcast episodes. Today, I speak to Dr. Monica Gandhi, an infectious disease specialist and professor of medicine at the University of California at San Francisco. I ask her a series of questions about her research into asymptomatic infection, including whether a face mask may be far more protective to the wearer than we have realized to date. Let's listen. Dr. Gandhi, thank you so much for joining me today on the podcast. I want to start with this idea of asymptomatic infection. You've been quoted widely talking about the importance of really understanding asymptomatic infection from COVID. Could you explain?
Yes. So the thing about COVID that's been so interesting is how protean, as Dr. Fauci says, its manifestations are, its clinical manifestations are. You can be completely fine and have no symptoms, or you can get profoundly ill and die. And it's amazing the range of expression of this virus. And unlike other viruses that we're really concerned about, it seems like there's a very fair percentage of people who get zero symptoms at all. That's what asymptomatic means. And so the CDC currently estimates as of July 10th that 40% of people who get infected with COVID have no symptoms at all. And that can be a good thing. That can be a bad thing because you could spread it, but that can be a good thing too, because it means that you don't get sick.
And so how do masks fit in to this question of asymptomatic infection?
So this question of how facial masking fits in to asymptomatic infection has been something our research group has been working on, and it's been a very interesting question, which is that it seems as if you can drive up the rates of asymptomatic infection by wearing masks. And what I mean by that is you likely can't change a lot of your own body like a host and who gets sick and who doesn't, but you can change what happens with the virus by putting a mask on. And we gathered evidence from three kind of major fields. One was virology, one was looking at outbreaks where people were masking, and one was looking at countries, and put it all together in a piece that describes how we think masks protect you from getting severe disease.
So let me ask you about the virology. What's the reason that a mask would make you more likely to get an asymptomatic infection than a very severe infection?
So the virology aspect about that is that masks actually, no matter what kind of mask, filters out the majority of viral particles. So if you're exposed to the virus, if you're wearing an N95 mask, you're going to have more filtering out of viral particles. But even a cloth mask, a surgical mask, kind of any mask you wear will filter out lots of the virus, a lot of the viral particles. So if you do get infected, you get less virus in. And what we know from virology and from animal models is the less virus you get in, what's called the inoculum or the dose, the less likely you are to get sick. This has actually been around since 1938. That was the oldest paper that we could find that people had defined what's called the LD50 of a virus, the lethal dose 50. The dose at which 50% of animals become sick and die, so lethal dose. And of course, we haven't defined the LD50 for viruses in humans because that wouldn't be ethical, but there have been many, many studies in animals that show the more virus you get in, the more sick you get. And then we can't do this with this particular virus in humans, but we have done it in hamsters. So in a hamster model, the more SARS-CoV-2, the virus that causes COVID-19 that you give to hamsters, the more sick they get. And if you give them less, they get less sick.
This may seem like a kind of a simple question, but why do you think that is?
Yeah, it's a great question, actually. And I think the reason that the higher the dose you get, the more sick you get, is actually has to do with your own immune response. With viruses, where your immune response has a big role to play with how sick you are, and that would be like SARS-CoV-2, and there are many viral infections where your immune system plays a big role in how sick you get. And it's when you get too much virus into your system, what's called the innate immune response goes crazy. It sends out cytokines, and it's doing everything in its power to fight all this virus that's coming in. And it actually becomes part of the pathology. So these are diseases that cause what we call immunopathology. And so that's actually why we give dexamethasone for people who have severe COVID-19, because it's helping calm down that immune response, which contributes to the pathology, contributes to the pathogenesis of the virus.
In other words, if you have a little bit of virus, then you have a modest immune response that can take care of the virus. But if you get a huge amount of virus, the immune system fights back so hard it can wind up kind of attacking the body.
Exactly right. That if you get a little bit of virus, you can have an organized immune response. You can wall off the infection and you have very few symptoms. If you have too much virus coming in, part of the very disease that's happening to you is the immune system going crazy, releasing lots of inflammatory markers, and it contributes to you getting sick. And so we use steroids to calm that down, or even better yet, don't get a huge viral inoculum.
Now, you also said that there was some evidence for this beyond just the viral science, virology, from outbreak studies. Can you explain?
Yes. So as we've been looking at outbreaks, and over time, there's been so many outbreaks of COVID-19, you can look and see that any outbreak that occurs in a setting where there's universal masking is accompanied by a really high proportion of people who get asymptomatic disease. So what I told you before is the CDC says right now, okay, 40% of people are asymptomatic. But if you look at settings where people are masking, only about 95% of people are asymptomatic, and I can explain that. But there's, for example, a cruise ship. Let's look at these. We call it the tale of two cruise ships. But the Diamond Princess cruise ship was a cruise ship where there was a lot of attention paid to it because it was the first one, and 20% of people were asymptomatic. And people weren't regularly masking or anything. We didn't even know about it then. Then there was an Argentinian cruise ship that was published in another paper. And at this point, they had an outbreak, but they gave everyone masks. They gave all the passengers masks. They gave all the cruise staff masks. And the rate of asymptomatic infection in the outbreak was 81%. And then...
So wait, just to be clear, where there were no masks, out of five people who got sick... Got sick, yes. But with they gave masks to everyone, just one out of five people got sick.
Correct. It was totally the opposite, actually. And that's a great symbol that like cruise ships are sort of closed settings and people aren't coming in and out. And that was a good example. It's kind of the same population. They had the same age range. You know, there tended to be older people, but there was 81% no symptoms on the cruise ship that masked. And then there were two outbreaks in the United States in meat processing plants. One was in Oregon in a seafood processing plant. One was in Arkansas in a Tyson chicken plant. And in both settings, workers were given masks before they went in and they were mandated to wear masks. But they had outbreak anyway. And in this outbreak, 95% in both settings were asymptomatic, had no symptoms at all. And that was really interesting because this mandated mask use led to 95% of people not getting sick. That is a great thing if you can drive it up to 95%, which is why I firmly believe that any workplace that opens up should be handing out masks.
Even if it's people are distanced, for example.
Even if they're distanced, because I do think that masking probably is more important than distancing. And there's been some models that show that. I would rather be in a crowd and masked than have everyone away from me. And so I do think the mask is that powerful in terms of reducing your viral inoculum. And I feel really confident going out in public with a mask.
The third line of evidence you said was about countries.
Yes. And this would be the third line of evidence around countries is more what we call ecologic data, but it is an interesting aspect that countries that were fine with masking, that don't have controversy around masking, that kind of universally recommended masking from early on, have had really low death rates. They've had really low rates of severe illness. So a good example is that many Asian countries who had experienced SARS, and I mean Hong Kong and Singapore and Taiwan and Vietnam and Thailand and Japan and parts of China, they had experienced SARS. So they were used to universal masking. It was not controversial, no big deal. Everyone just went out, they opened society, and they all wore masks. And when they have cases, they have very little severe illness. In fact, Taiwan, of a country of 23 million, has had 7 deaths total from this pandemic, even though they've been open for months. But everyone's still wearing masks. And they mass produce masks in March. And then I like to bring up the Czech Republic, because it's not an Asian country that experienced SARS, but the Czech Republic just did it. They were like, on March 23rd, they made a universal masking policy. Everyone obeyed. They all wore masks. And they did great. They have very few deaths, very few severe illness. So, you know, it is, I'm sure a lot of other things was going on, but they've had very low case fatality rates in countries that universally mask.
So let me ask you a few questions that skeptics of this might pose to you. Are you worried that people won't know they're sick, but they're still passing it on?
No, because the reason that I hate asymptomatic infection is that people can pass it on. But the reason that I love asymptomatic infection is that you don't pass it on if you wear a mask. So the entire point of the CDC's initial recommendations to our country on April 3rd to say that we should be wearing masks out in public was actually to prevent you from giving it to others. And so I do believe in the power of the mask to prevent transmission to others. So if you're going to be out in public and you're wearing a mask, you get less in, but you're also not going to spread it to others. So I'm very happy with the universal population level masking idea of reducing both transmission and reducing severe disease.
What do we know about immunity for people who have asymptomatic infection? Because if you get an asymptomatic infection, but then you're still at risk for getting sick, maybe you've delayed things, but you haven't really altered very much the situation in the population.
Yes, I think the best part of getting asymptomatic infection, if you're going to get infected, is that we've been having some really great data, and it's really over the last month or so, that asymptomatic infection seems to trigger immunity. So remember, when we think about immunity, we should always remember that there's kind of two arms of the immune response, and there's antibodies that we usually think of fighting other infections like bacteria, but it's really viruses, their main arm of the immune system that gives you long-lasting immunity to viruses, are T cells. Our cell-mediated immunity. So when we do those antibody studies and we say, oh, 5% of people in Madrid have been exposed to the virus, that's not true. An antibody response can wane over time with the virus. It's really the T cells that we care about to know if you have long-lasting immunity. And there's been some great studies, including one coming out of University of Washington. They have a preprint and it's under review in a great journal right now that shows that asymptomatic infection can give you T-cell immunity, really strong T-cell immunity. And strong T-cell immunity is going to last you for a very long time, maybe until we get the vaccine or maybe for longer. So it is very hopeful to think that not having symptoms will also trigger immunity.
Some people may hear this and they may think, well, then I want asymptomatic infection. Maybe I should go out and try to figure out how to get an asymptomatic infection. Is that something you recommend?
I do not recommend trying to go out and getting infected, just because I also do think that the dance between a virus and a host is a true dance. What I mean by that is I absolutely think that the lower viral dose you get in, the less sick you get. However, you as a host also has something to do with it. Your own immune system has something to do with it. It really is an interplay between virus and host. So what I would prefer is that when people go out, they always wear a mask. Even if you're in public, even if you're outside, just kind of being around people you don't know, wear that mask. And if you do get infected, you're likely to get an asymptomatic infection. But I wouldn't encourage going out and getting infected. But I, on the other hand, I'm going to say this is a very contagious virus, which is why we keep on seeing this case surges, even in places that have controlled it. And so the reason that I think it's so important to think about masking is we want to do two things with this virus. We want to decrease transmission. transmission, but we also want to decrease morbidity. And this masking will do both. I mean, that's a very simple intervention.
Right. Fewer cases and fewer people really getting sick.
And so that's why I love this idea of one simple intervention getting us through it. That to me feels like it's kind of a no-brainer. We should be doing it. We may have to do it for 6 months, may have to do it for a year. I don't know how long it's going to take us, but I think we need to be doing it.
Well, thank you so much for your time explaining this and all the different lines of evidence and for all the work that you're doing to help people understand what they can do to protect themselves.
Thank you very much for having me on.
Public Health On Call is produced by Joshua Sharfstein, Lindsay Smith-Rogers, Stephanie Desmond, and Lamari Morales. Audio production by Spencer Greer, Niall Owen McCusker, Cian Oates, and Matthew Martin, with support from Chip Hickey. Distribution by Nick Moran. Thank you for listening.